If I could just take y'all in a group, I'd take you down to the place I love so much, and it truly is my home, down on John's Island. I'd take you to Apapula Creek. I'd put you on the floating dock, and I'd say, take off your socks and shoes and dangle your feet in the water. It's wonderful. And if my granddaddy were alive, he'd be out there fishing and shrimping and casting. And you know, we live by the pull of the tides in the low country. We plan our day around the tides. And I love high tide. It's absolutely gorgeous. Low tide is not so pretty. There's stuff in there that D-Heck would find my daddy over if they could. You know, you kind of hide these things. And still there on low tide. And when it's high tide, of course, it's underneath the high water, but we don't focus on those things. And that's when you crab. You know, you crab on low tide. It's when the little, they come up and nibble your toes. And they're there on high tide, but you don't focus on it. It's just life's just like that. We have those highs and the lows. How do we have good high tides when we know we want things to go well? What do you do? Our wonderful doctor recipient said it all. You surround yourself with the right people. That was so great. Thank you for sharing that. You do. That's what you do. And on that creek, I have the right people in my life because they balance the tides. Now, I got to tell you about my cousin Teta. She was a school teacher, and she retired. She said, the churn are bad. Children, churn. Churn are bad. So she retired. And the very last day of school, a very irate parent came up to her with their fist like this, and I got a good mind to knock your teeth down your throat. She said, I'll save you the trouble. She took out her dentures. See, Cousin Teddy taught me to use a sense of humor in life. Now, Aunt Josie's another one of my creep people. Now, Aunt Josie is very enthusiastic. She's 92. She's in a nursing home. And this gorgeous man walked in. She got that walker right up in his face. Said, land sakes, you look just like my third husband. He said, my goodness, lady, how many times you been married? She said, twice. Nothing great was ever accomplished without enthusiasm. Now, Aunt Josie loves to talk about the fact that she was one of the first female clerks at Rich's department store in Atlanta, Georgia. She talks like this. And this good old farmer, good old boy from South Georgia came in, had his overalls on, was in a little bit of a panic. Now, this is a long time ago. And he went up to her and he said, lady, lady, I got to have me some panties. She said, excuse me? I got to have some panties. So she took him to the lingerie department. She was very uncomfortable. And she said, sir, these panties for your daughter? Please say yes. He said, no, they ain't for my daughter. She said, your wife? No, they ain't for my wife. Neither they for me. She said, I'm sorry, sir. Why do you have to have panties? He said, I got to have panties to put in the meter. Now, we all communicate differently, don't we? I love Proverbs. It's a great proverb. It says, a relaxed attitude lengthens a man's life. That's just de-stressing yourself. That's important to do. Now, my cousin Bob and his wife Elizabeth, I'm telling y'all, they are the most laid-back people, some more of my creek people. They were in bed one night, and a robber had broken in, put the gun at Elizabeth's head and said, what's your name? She said, Elizabeth. He said, I can't kill you. That was my mama's name. He put the gun at Bob's head and said, what's your name? He said, Bob, but my friends call me Elizabeth. Now, he is something else. Because Elizabeth said she was changing in the bathroom, getting ready to get in the bed. And she glanced up, said, oh, for heaven's sakes, looked at herself, got in bed with Bob, said, saw myself in the mirror. And I'm going to tell you something, I'm fat, wrinkled, old, and ugly. I wish you'd give me a compliment. He said, you got good eyesight. And they are still married. See, I like people like that. I got a cousin Earl. Now I got to brag on Earl. Anybody bass fishing here? Earl had Stratus boats. He invented that boat. He's from Nashville, Tennessee. And he went on and sold it and then invented this wonderful new boat called Triton. And it's made out of stealth bomber material. Just sold that. He's president of Brunswick now. Doing great. But you know what I love about Earl? Taught me a lesson. And I know all of you in here that have been serving so many people, you know, like I've always heard, the more authority you have, the more of a humble heart you should have. You should have a servant's heart. And Earl's been like that. And I said, Earl, what you been doing? This was a couple of months ago when I saw him. He said, Jane, I've been entertaining a Texan, a boat dealer of mine who does nothing but brag. Drives me crazy. He said, I got in the car with him at the Nashville airport. We rode down the interstate, little old rabbit scampered across. He said, what's that, Earl? Earl said, a rabbit. He said, mighty small in Texas to come up to here. Here he goes again. He said, a little bit further down the road, he looked up on the hill, said, Earl, what's up on a hill? Earl said, a goat. He said, goat, mighty small in Texas to come up to here. He said, man, I had had it with him, took him to my brand new pond I just dug. He said, great big turtles crossing right across the road. Texas said, hey, Earl, what's that? Earl said, a tick. It's really fun when you say tick, put lots of syllables in it. We had a friend that, we're just a friend of the family. You know, you have folks that help on the farm and they just become family, they do. And so we had a fella work forever and we had a little name we called him. We called him Bomb Initials. I never knew why, that was just his name, Bomb Initials. And my daddy, he would go to the bank and have a lockbox and pay his men. That way we didn't have fancy check writing machines. But it was during tomato time, and Daddy got too busy, forgot to go to the bank, and Bomb Initials drove up, and Daddy went, oh my goodness, I forgot to go to the bank. So Bomb Initials came up, and he said, I'm so sorry. Daddy told him, he said, I didn't have time to go to the bank. He said, oh, that's all right, Mr. Benjamin. Daddy said, you know what I could do is just write you a check, a personal check. He said, oh, that'd be good, that'd be good. So Daddy gets his pen out and says, you know, I'm really embarrassed to say this. Can you just spell out your name for me? He said, oh, Mr. Jenkins, just make it up to C.W. Jones. And Daddy started writing. He said, C.W. Jones? He said, who is that? He said, well, that's me. He said, you? That's your name? He said, yes, sir. He said, but we've called you Bomb Initials for years. He said, yes, sir. He said, I thought it was kind of strange, Mr. Jenkins, my first day here. And you looked at me and said, what you want us to call you by? And I said, you could just call me Bomb Initials. And that's exactly what we did. You just surround yourself with good folk. You surround yourself with those folks and keep yourself on a high tide when that low tide's just pulling at you. And we have low tides. Oh, my goodness. All of us do. And I will tell you throughout my life, all the highs and the lows, I just can recall that day in first grade. I was a tomboy. I had real short hair, had my corduroy pants and my flannel shirt. And those big high school girls said, now we're going to pick out cute little girls tomorrow to be in Little Miss Merry Christmas. Well, honey, that had my name written all over it. It's like that little seed was just planted there. And I remember I was so excited, all dressed up and just smile real big, and that was a problem too because I'd lost my teeth. And these lips had never changed size. Mama said, honey, just don't pout, you might trip. But you will grow into them one day. I couldn't wait for that day to come. And I remember standing there, I was just screaming, pick me. We've all been there. And they kept looking next to me. And I finally looked to her, I said, for heaven's sake, it was Deborah Draughty. Her mama had put a stick-out dress on her that day. She had on her patent leather shoes and her poodle socks. Her mama put those pink spongy rollers in her hair. And she had put on number 5 Avon Red Tester. Remember the little white testers? I hope you gentlemen don't, but the ladies probably do. She was precious, and I wanted to slap her. And she had her teeth. So, of course, they picked her. But something inside of me said, I'm going to do this. I don't know what it was. You know, but I know now what it was. It's because I was raised on a farm. I saw my daddy drag in tired, but he never gave up. My sister got married on cucumber rebate money. There was no public assistance that I knew of. I sent myself to study music and art in Europe from picking tomatoes one summer, and I worked in the fields. That's what you did. I did not give up. And I remember later that day, I got on the school bus, and there was that high school girl, and I walked up to her just as bold as you please. I got up in her face. I said, "Hey, I can play the harmonica." She said, "You can?" I said, "Mm-hmm." She said, "Well, you'll have to be in our little program." I said, "Thank you." And I sat down, and a wave of panic hit me. I do not know how to play the harmonica. My mother plays the harmonica. Oh, my gosh. I worried. I lied. I worried all the next day. Got on the bus. I thought it was a miracle. She was on my route. I didn't realize that's what happened, you know. And I got right up in her face that next morning, and I said, "I got to fix this." I told a lie. And I looked at her, and I said, "My harmonica's broken." Told a bigger lie. You know, my brother was in high school, and he came home, and he said, "Jane, we need a fishbowl in this pageant." And my two little old fish, Simon and Garfunkel, they had lived a good long life. And I said, "It's time for them to go." So I dumped them in a bigger bowl and flushed them. I said, "You'll be happy, I promise." I was telling my husband. He said, "That is sick." I said, "No, it's not. I was passionate." And I remember that night at St. John's Auditorium. Remember those old slanted wooden auditoriums? Those heavy, heavy, heavy velvet curtains. And those girls walked out with those big old chiffon dresses just flowing with these long white gloves. Big old beehive hairdos, as we say in the South, jacked up to Jesus. So help me, they were big old hairdos. And they put their hands in my fishbowl and pulled out a question. And that just did something to me. And my chair kept falling and I kept picking myself back up. And it fell again, and it fell again, and it fell again, and I kept picking it up because it was broken on the front row. And I can tell you it was because I don't believe in stopping trying or trying stopping, because I was raised on a farm. And little did I know that just 15 years later, I'd be walking across the stage in Atlantic City, New Jersey, in the Miss America Pageant.